Today we're speaking with Robin Washington, the new editor-at-large for The Forward. Welcome, Robin.
Thank you, Sheree. Great to be here again.
So thank you. Can you tell us a little bit about why is this position as editor-at-large important for The Forward, for the Jewish community, for us as you're here based in Duluth, Minnesota, for us as Minnesotans?
Well, I hope it is important. So we'll find out, right? Won't we? I think I'll back up a little bit and tell you what the position is. It is, again, editor at large, which is not editor in chief. Sounds like that. I hear some people saying, hey, great, you're going to be running the thing. No, I'm not. We have a very fine and capable editor in chief in Jody Rudroin, and who's the last name I just mispronounced badly, but it sounded good, didn't it? I'm sure she'll forgive me. And she runs the place, and she'll continue to do that as editor at large. It's a new position. It is, as we in journalism call it, a masthead position. The official duties are to write an opinion column, to develop and host an interview show, because I've got all these years in broadcast that should translate and should help bring The Forward as it goes into well into his second century, help recruit diverse contributors and sources, I would add, and consult across the organization's leadership on addressing systemic racism. So any one of those could be a full-time job, and any one of those are full-time jobs I've had before. You could abbreviate a lot of it as DEI. And I think in answering what that was, I told you why it was important, but to elaborate a little bit, it's important because without diverse voices, and particularly, at least in my expertise, or one of them, of bringing forth or giving power to voices of ethnically diverse Jews, without those voices, you don't get a complete picture of Judaism. It doesn't serve anybody well, either Jews, non-Jews, or different types of Jews.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. And then because you're also here, and for being a national, in some ways, an international publication, and you're based here in Minnesota, the epicenter of race in America right now, as we're still dealing with the aftermath of the George Floyd's murder. How do you think your position, you mentioned it is DEI, put that spotlight on race and diversity issues as they relate to Minnesota?
Well, again, let me go back to a little bit of background, which is my background. I'm born and raised in Chicago, came to Minnesota in the 80s, then went to Boston for 17 years and came back to Minnesota eventually to be the editor in chief, if you will, of the Duluth News Tribune, and still do work back in Boston, back and forth since I left that position almost 10 years ago now. And so the reason I say that is epicenters seem to follow me wherever I go. I mean, you know, I grew up in Chicago, which was not the epicenter of the civil rights movement, but it was a big part of it. And I grew up very much in that. And then in Boston, one of the areas that I happened to cover for the Boston Herald at the time was the Catholic Church sex abuse scandal, which indeed followed me to Minnesota because we had some really horrific things in the Superior Wisconsin diocese right next door. So I'm kind of used to it. It's like wherever I go, big news follows me. And that may be kind of the journalistic, not callous, but we've seen it all, you know, look at the world where in fact big news is terrible tragedies that affect real live human beings, obviously. The George Floyd tragedy affected most seriously George Floyd and his family, but all of us in the world. What's it mean? Well, rather than saying what does it mean to Jewfolk of various different folks, let's just say the accident of me once again being in the epicenter. And I've been, you know, not just insulated in Duluth. I've been down in the cities and haven't been covering the story. Let's just say again, that's going to give a broader picture to our, you know, nationwide, worldwide Jewish audience.
Okay. And then also related to that, because you also recently joined the board of the Jewish Community Relations Council of Minnesota, MNDAC, JCRC, Why did joining the board interest you?
Well, I mean, I've been friends with the people on the council for years, and I don't know if I can say I've done work with them, but I've certainly been related and conscious and supportive of what they do. And one thing I did anyway last year was the study of the boards of directors of the Council of Presidents of Major Jewish Organizations in the United States. This is the makeup of the boards that direct the major Jewish organizations in this country and pretty much the world. And my assistant and I, he's a great numbers cruncher, David Shafroff here in Duluth, we looked at the boards of all these organizations, and we looked at their racial and ethnic makeup, where we couldn't see by a picture, and you can't tell race necessarily by a picture. We researched family backgrounds and names and geography and all kinds of stuff. I've done this before. In fact, David and I have done this before in Boston for looking at corporate boards, and we were commissioned to do those studies. And so we were kind of used to this. This was the obvious one to do in the wake of George Floyd's murder, we can now say, by the way, and where a lot of these organizations were saying, deploring racism, deploring the status quo, deploring the conditions that led to this unacceptable racial condition in this country, but they weren't looking at themselves. And so the significance of that study, it found that 0.2% of the makeup of Jewish organizations, major Jewish organizations in the United States, were Black Jews. That was two people out of 2,000 board members. Jews of color, if you go and expand it to include Asian, Hispanic, and Native American, and then you've got Mizrahi, it's sort of sometimes of color, not people can identify different ways, but in any case, that came out to 2%. And by any standard, by the lowest estimates of the Jewish ethnic population, Black Jews make up, and we're not talking about Ethiopians, we're talking about in the United States. So in the United States, Black Jews make up the lowest possible estimate you could get would be 2%, which means that they are grossly underrepresented on these boards. And again, the lowest possible estimate you could get of Jews of color would be something like 6%, and again, 2%. It's hard to take all those in on the video here, but we'll have the links, I'm sure, to my study. You can see it. Grossly underrepresented, no matter how you look at it. What does this mean? Is that the article was about boards of directors. It wasn't about staffers. And I'm not saying you don't need Jewish, Black Jewish, or Jews of color on the staff. You need that too. But if you want to see change in these organizations, you got to do it with the board. It's a long answer to your question, but that's the change I'm about. I am unabashedly, I'm sure I said on my previous visit Jewfolk that I am about advocacy journalism, but I do it with all the tenets of fair journalism too. But my advocacy is toward repairing the world, making a better place, and I'm uncompromising about that.
Thank you. And as a final remark, you know, there's a lot of talk nationally about being an anti-racist versus not being racist. And regardless of what you think the word racist means, there is that talk about anti-racist work. So is there anything else you want people to know about race in America as it relates to being to people of color who are Jews? What else do you want our audience to know about?
That's one of the books I haven't written. Now here I am taking on, you know, yet another duty. I still have my show on Wisconsin.
Right. It doesn't have to be about the definition of racist. I don't necessarily want to go there today.
No.
So, but in general, serious, just what people know.
I'll give you the short answer. But the short answer is, it's not a short answer. The short answer is you've got to learn all about race. You got to learn about yourself. You got to be open to learning about yourself as you learn about others, and maybe before you do. I'm going to tell you right now, I have a little problem with the whiteness studies and white people talking to white people about racism. there in that's on the surface sounds good, but inherently it creates an issue where it almost kind of says you don't have to deal with people of color as you talk about racism. Well, that's not true. I think you do need the people of color in the room to tell you, keep you honest or something like that. And this is not to say, well, all white people do everything bad and they're all wrong about stuff. But if you're going to start talking about this difficult and hard to understand issue, you know, people think that it's an easy thing. Oh, race isn't really, because of institutional racism, you get the feeling that race is, oh, it doesn't matter. You don't have to talk about it. It's just a minor thing. It's not hard like nuclear physics, okay? Yes, it is. If it weren't so hard, we wouldn't be, you know, spending thousands of years dealing with this. If I had a short prescription for what you're saying, I would say I'm going to say white Jews, and then I put the asterisk by that because are Jews white? That's a whole long question. So understand that first. You know, what does whiteness mean as a Jew? Frankly, if I had a short answer to that, to say that if you were a Jew, Ashkenazi, European descent, which I am, as well as of African descent, but if you were one and you weren't of African descent somehow, you probably are, but if you really, really weren't, you look like a basic white person. Yes, you get white privilege from being able to walk around in stores. And, you know, not long ago, I was at Target and I had my phone out and see my sweater here and I want to do that. Do I do that at a Target? Hell no. It's just my conditioning. I don't get stopped a lot because I practice this self-preservation kind of, stuff, right? White people don't think about that. So, okay, that's what white privilege is. It's probably not a good phrase, but now that you understand it, maybe, you know, you can do that. But on the other hand, does that mean there's no anti-Semitism? Hell no. So, you know, if you think your white privilege it gets you into Kitigami Club here in Duluth, right? Well, probably helps. For years, they didn't allow anybody to look like you or me in that club. And you, as a female, would have to go through the back door, by the way. So you got two ways you're not getting in that place. But today, they allow Jews and Italians. Gino Pellucci wouldn't go in there even long after they allowed Italians. I digress. If you think there's not anti-Semitism because of your white privilege or you identify as white, you've got an issue, you've got some self-reckoning to deal with. And then maybe you can begin to understand or start taking in issues of people of color. But it's all happening now. So there's not a lot of time, you know, for the 101 course.
Okay. And then one more. I know I said my other question was my final question, but one more just in terms of, right, because you're in Duluth right now. Next time you're in the Twin Cities, what's something fun that you're looking forward to? Is it a certain restaurant? Is it the theater? Is it, you know, our chain of lakes, even though you have the best lake there with Lake Superior, but what is something fun that you're looking forward to the next time you come into the Twin Cities?
Yeah. Duluthians don't really go to the cities for the lakes. Okay. I think we got that one covered. And if we want some little ones, we got those too. So, I don't know. Actually, I usually go to the cities for, frankly, work events or, you know, meetings or, you know, various organizations, whatever. So,
you have a favorite restaurant when you get here?
Not really. So, we live in Duluth for a reason, you know?
Thank you, Robin. It's always a pleasure speaking with you and getting a chance to see you again here, but we look forward to seeing you the next time you come into the Twin Cities in person, even if it's socially distanced. Right. So,
And when, you know, COVID over, God willing, come on up here. You're all invited.
Thank you very much. Okay. Have a great day.
You too.